Today's video is brought to you by CleanMyMac X, your Mac as good as new. Hey, it's Chris, and today we're gonna be talking about macOS Catalina. Now, here's what's coming up in this video. I wanna start things out by talking about a few underrated features that you're probably not hearing a whole lot about on other channels and blogs right now. And then I wanna talk about four of the big main features and how I'm using those. And then at the end, we're gonna end this with a Q&A. I asked you guys on YouTube what you wanted to know, and so that's gonna be a great way to wrap this up. All right, so underrated stuff. Everyone else is talking about screen time and whatever, and we're gonna talk about a few things that nobody else is even mentioning right now. So one of my favorite things is Apple Notes, because it just works. One of my favorite things in Apple Notes in Catalina is a new dropdown that lets me have the option to take a photo or scan a document or insert a sketch from my iPhone or my iPad. What? So let's say I need to scan a contract or something like I do sometimes. I'm on my Mac, I got Apple Notes open, I hit this menu and I say iPhone and scan document. What happens? I go to my iPhone, it's already on and it's opened up to the scanning functionality. So if I'm at my desk, this is like a super amazing workflow. Scan the document and boom, from the iPhone right into the Apple Note on my Mac. I love this. So same thing with photos on your iPhone probably, or sketches if you've used the Apple Pencil over on your iPad and you wanna get that over and into whatever note in Catalina. I'm gonna talk more about Apple Notes in a little bit. I am super excited about this next thing I'm about to mention. Window management. Windows management, whatever. In the past, if you wanted to like organize your windows and like snap them all around, like you can do in Windows, by the way, really easily, you had to use like a third party app. And I've mentioned several before, one of them being like Magnet, for instance. So now you get some built-in functionality to manage your windows in Catalina, which is cool. So the way that you find this is in the top left of a window where you have like your red and your yellow and your green buttons, those little circles, hover over the green button, which is your full screen button, and just give it a second, and then you're gonna get a menu there that's gonna let you snap something, tile it over to the left, or snap it or tile it over to the right, or go full screen with it. And on top of that, we're gonna talk about Sidecar in just a minute. From this menu, you can also send a window directly over to Sidecar on your iPad. This is so cool. Oh, you know, I'm gonna mention right here the new screensaver. I bet hardly anybody is talking about this, but there's a new screensaver, finally, and it's called Drift. This is like an area that's been neglected for a long time. Your Mac is not always in use, and sometimes it's just sitting there. Like if you're in your dorm room or something, or even in your office, and you're not using your Mac, the screen's still going, and it could be cool to have a really nice screensaver over there, and not the same old boring a couple that you're used to. I can't even describe to you what Drift is, like what it looks like. I'm not even gonna try, I'm just gonna show you, let you stare at it. And it can change contextually, like you can have it set to reflect the colors of what's on the desktop or like a spectrum of different colors. It's a little bit adjustable. I just like that finally we have a new screensaver. Not a huge deal, but cool. Okay, so let's get into some of the bigger features in Catalina. The biggest one for me is Sidecar. I mean, this is like my favorite thing in macOS Catalina, to be honest. So Sidecar, if for some reason you haven't heard about it yet, is basically gonna let you turn your iPad into a second screen. It works wirelessly or wired, and is very speedy and snappy, even wirelessly. If you've used something like Duet Display in the past, there was a little bit of lag. This seems a lot faster to me. It's super convenient. So you go hit the menu up in the top right of your screen and select an iPad. It's that simple, and then boom, just like that, it pops up. You got a second screen. There's several instances where this is really great. And by the way, I've been using the Catalina beta for a long time, so I've put a lot of hours into this already. So when I'm telling you this, it's because I've been able to use this stuff. Number one, best use is like when you're traveling or you're going to the coffee shop. You got your Mac, you got your iPad. The ability to have a second screen is monumental because it's a huge productivity boost to not have to be swapping around different windows and stuff's buried. To just have something that you're working on and something that you're referencing over here on the iPad is great. Second thing is when I'm at my desk, I have a new super ultra wide monitor. And when I'm using that, which I love doing, I made a video about it, so go check it out. When I'm using it, it doesn't have the highest resolution in the game. It's good, but it's not as good as my Mac or my iPad. So when I'm doing something like editing a photo or doing some video editing, and I need a preview to be extra crispy as possible, then I can use Sidecar to make sure that whatever I'm editing looks really great, down to the pixel. In fact, this is so good. I'm so excited about Sidecar that it's influencing my next iPad buying decision. I went with the 11-inch iPad Pro last time. In the coming announcement, hopefully at the end of October here, I'm gonna be getting the new 12.9-inch or whatever the biggest size of the iPad Pro is, specifically to take advantage of Sidecar, because I love it that much. And just in case you're wondering, I can actually have my Mac open for that screen, I can have the super ultra wide going for that screen, and I can have the iPad Pro, or it would work with any other iPad too. I've tried it with the base level iPad as well, works great there too. So I'm gonna have three screens effectively going at the same time with Sidecar. So it's very powerful. Here's the other big thing with Sidecar. You can use the Apple Pencil there and edit whatever's on your Mac using the Apple Pencil instead of your mouse, or as an alternative, something like a Wacom tablet. So here's a good usage scenario. Photoshop, when I'm doing like a mask, like cutting something out, I don't know how into photo editing stuff you are, it's so much more accurate and so much easier to use the Apple Pencil to do that than to use the mouse. So very, very handy. And you can use this to mark up documents and stuff too, whether it's a screenshot or a PDF. The Apple ecosystem was amazing before, but these are the kind of inter-device interactions that just put it so far over the top and just put it into the ridiculous level compared to other ecosystems. I know Sidecar is like hugely popular because the video I made about it before is really taking off. If you guys want to check out the video that I made about this with a bunch of different uses and how you can make the most out of it, then check it out and I'll link it up down below too. Apple Arcade is the next big feature that I want to mention today, because look, I never thought of the Mac as a gaming device. I never did. And really, it's like a running joke, kind of like Macs are not gaming devices. And still, even with Apple Arcade, which brings 100 plus games to the Mac and to all the Apple devices for a subscription every month, a family subscription, by the way, it's got a lot of value here, then it still isn't really like a hardcore gamer's dream. But even so, all of a sudden, if I want to take a break from work, I can actually stay at my Mac and flip open a game and do a little casual gaming and take a break. It's really nice. Instead of having to go grab an iPad or go hit the iPhone, like you can take advantage of a bigger screen. Oh, and speaking of bigger screens, something else I love about Apple Arcade and the fact that it's on the Mac and all the Apple devices is the iCloud continuity. So if you make some progress in a game on your Mac or your iPhone, and then you wanna pick that up when you get home on the Apple TV and really play it on your biggest screen in the house, then you can do that thanks to iCloud continuity. So it's not just that it's on the Mac, and it's not just that it's on the iPhone, it's that it's everywhere. Apple Arcade games seem to run really smooth on the Mac. I have a 2016 MacBook Pro that I'm using with this setup, and so I checked out Hot Lava and it ran flawlessly. And by the way, if you haven't played it yet, I really like the intro, which if you grew up in the 90s, is very reminiscent of the retro Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. So pretty cool. One thing I'll point out about Apple Arcade on the Mac is that I haven't seen all the titles there yet. So for instance, Oceanhorn 2, I've been really getting into that. Definitely one of the best games on Apple Arcade so far. And you can use it with a controller. It's definitely more of like a console-ish kind of a game. So I got it going with my Xbox controller over on my Apple TV. But anyways, it's not there on the Mac App Store yet. Oh, and actually I'm thinking about making an Apple Arcade video talking about which device is the most fun to play Apple Arcade games on and which games work and look the best on what devices and answering all your questions there. So if you want a deeper dive into Apple Arcade, let me know and let me know what you want to see. Leave me a comment. Another big thing for me here with Catalina, and it's bigger than a lot of people realize, at least to me, is all the new apps. Now, there's two different categories that I'm talking about here. The new Apple apps, that's one category, and the other is the new third-party apps. We're gonna talk about both of those. On the Apple side of things, iTunes is dead. It's gone on the Mac. And in its place, everything's been split up. So there's now a separate music app, separate podcast, Apple TV, whatever. The only one I'm super really interested in is the Apple Music app. I love that it's been separated. I love that it's its own thing because it's super simple now and easy to use, much cleaner navigation, for instance. So when it comes time to listen to something, open it up and I can get right into listening and spend less time browsing around than I could in iTunes like right away. It's way faster, much cleaner. And I also really like the now playing screen, which has been redesigned. And so it actually turns into kind of a little widget, and then you can see your history of what you've listened to. So if you want to go back and listen to something that you just liked, or what's coming up, and then you can also see the lyrics right there too. So really liking the Apple Music experience in this standalone app. And another really big thing for me is the redesigned Reminders app. So I've said this a million times, you guys are so sick of it, but my life runs on Apple's Reminders, usually made through Siri, usually on the Apple Watch. And so anytime I need to remember something, I make a reminder and then I forget about it. So the old Reminders app, I really only interacted with it by creating one through Siri and on my Apple Watch and then checking it off, usually on my iPhone. I never touched it on the Mac. It was there, but it was awful. It was ugly, wasn't very functional, basically just served up notifications. So now in Catalina, I keep it open all the time. It looks better, it's so much more functional. Some of the things that I like the best are the context. So if there's a reminder, I can easily do something like add a location to it with just a click so that I'm reminded with like a geofence when I get to Best Buy, I need to get this specific dongle, right? Another thing you can do is add a reminder when you're texting a specific person so that when you talk to somebody, when you have that conversation, you don't forget whatever you needed to. And finally, something that's been missing from Apple's Reminders app forever on all the different devices and instances is just being able to say, I don't want this to be today, I just want it to be tomorrow or this weekend. And now with one click, you can change that reminder from today to tomorrow or this afternoon or this weekend. It's very useful. Okay, so I kind of mentioned one of the great new Apple Notes features earlier in this video because I want to give you something really cool that no one else was talking about, but there's some other stuff that's worth talking about too. Now, it's not like a brand new app here, but the redesign is big enough, there's some new enough features that it belongs in this video. Number one, there's a gallery view, which is cool in and of itself, but what's even cooler is the new, more powerful search. So now, the search within your notes is smart enough to detect objects within photos or scenes, which is cool. If you're searching for like a mountain or something, you're now gonna be able to find it, hopefully. And the other thing is that it can search through what you've scanned in a document. So if you've scanned like a 20-page PDF and you need to find something within it, now you can. The other thing that's really cool is checklists. They got a lot cooler. So I don't know if you have used checklists for like your to-dos and stuff in Apple Notes, but now if you're doing it, once you check something off, it moves, whoop, down to the bottom of that list and kind of stays out of the way. It keeps you decluttered. It's just a more intuitive way to do a checklist and to-dos. The other thing is that you can drag and drop to rearrange stuff. So that's perfect too for like making a priority out of your list. I don't know, it's just better. It's more enjoyable. It's these little things that all add up, like I always say, to a better Apple experience. So there's some other cool updates to Apple apps like Mail and Safari. I'm not gonna dwell on those too much here, but know that those got a little bit better too. What I do wanna shift into is talking about all the new apps that are coming as iPad ports thanks to Mac Catalyst, which is something that let developers get their iPad apps over into the Mac Store really easily. Here's the thing, the Mac App Store had been getting kind of stale in recent years. There just wasn't a lot of cool development happening there. And so, on the other hand, there was a lot of really cool apps over on the iPad. You may even have some of them. And so I've already been seeing some really great ones moving over from the iPad to the Mac. One of the best ones is Planny 3. It's a really great to-do program and app that's just, it's all about visuals and the style. If you don't want something that's just boring and plain and too clean cut and all white and super minimal, Planny will like spice up your to-do stuff. And that has landed on the Mac. Another app that I'm really excited popped over to the Mac is something called Allegory, which is a note-taking app. And I just told you I'm way immersed into Apple Notes. And the reason I'm in Apple Notes is because I need something that's reliable, that's gonna sync all over the place and just works. I've been burned by lots of different note-taking apps. And by the way, something that's really secure too, because I got a bunch of business and personal stuff in. Allegory though is something that's is yelling at me like, hey, try me out. The reason is because it's so different. And if you need a different experience from a design standpoint, or just from all the different elements that get fused into your main screen, this is definitely something to be excited about and check out. One other example is just Carrot Weather, and I don't know why it costs $14 to get a weather app on your Mac, but whatever. I guess some people are just obsessed with Carrot. They love it, they love that snarky personality and the graphics and whatever, And so, you know what? If you're a huge Carrot Weather fan, it's your lucky day if you're a Mac owner too. One of the big reasons why I'm excited about this is because there's a lot of apps that I didn't want to use and get immersed in over on the iPad because it wasn't available everywhere. When I go looking for an app, especially a work-related or productivity thing, I want it to work on my iPhone, on my iPad, on my Mac, and on my Apple Watch at a minimum. And so that's really gonna start happening a lot more now that we have Mac Catalyst. macOS Catalina requires about 30 gigs of free space. Plus, you wanna back it up before upgrading and make sure there are less errors and system junk when upgrading, which is why you should consider using CleanMyMac X before making the jump, especially if your Mac is feeling a little tired or disorganized. Since Catalina no longer supports 32-bit apps, CleanMyMac X can delete them the right way with no leftovers, and the updater feature will make sure that you get the 64-bit replacements when they're available. With a beautiful design and dozens of cleanup and tune-up tools in one convenient app, CleanMyMac X can help you delete system junk and hidden clutter, speed up your Mac, remove malware and adware, and build an interactive map of your Mac's storage. It removes about 31 gigs of junk from the average Mac, so what are you waiting for? Give it a try using the link in the description. All right, let's pop into the question and answer part of this video. You guys, the technicians, came through with a bunch of great questions. I cannot get to them all, but I picked a few of them that at least I have something to say about. And we're gonna start with this one, which says, how do you feel about the removal of iTunes and placing the device syncing into Finder? So if you hooked up your iPhone in the past or your iPad, you had to go into iTunes and click on it in order to interact with it, grab files out of there and sync things, whatever. I'm actually a super huge fan of having it live in Finder. It makes a lot more sense to me. So here's an example of how I use this. I'll shoot a bunch of really high quality footage using Filmic Pro on the new iPhone 11 Pro. And when I need to pop that over into the computer, I can't just AirDrop these giant files, right? So the way to get those out of Filmic is to hook it up to your Mac and then go into your iPhone, now in the Finder window, not iTunes, and select Filmic Pro and grab your footage, copy it over. I like it. I have nothing bad to say about it. It's better. Another question from the same person is, have I noticed a speed increase or decrease if I've installed this on an older Mac? Well, I've only installed it on one Mac. It's my 2016 MacBook Pro. It's a maxed out 2016 model. So, I mean, it's pretty beefy for the specs back in 2016. And I haven't really honestly noticed either way, that being really fast or really slow with Catalina installed. So I guess I don't have any experience installing on something that's older than that, but I can tell you it just hasn't made too much of a difference speed-wise at all for me. Last question from same dude, what do I think about the changes to Photos and iMovie? I haven't messed around with iMovie yet, but I can say Photos, the new changes there, whether it's in Catalina or on your iPhone or iPad, I love this update to Photos. Being able to see stuff really easily by year, day, month, whatever, pinching and zooming, like seeing a bunch or a little at once, just it's so much easier to find stuff. It was a big adjustment, like learning how to use that. It wasn't hard to learn how, but it was like, whoa, this is way different, because it is, and it's a good change in my opinion. It's just easier to find stuff. Somebody says, how buggy is the software? Which is a fair question, because, and I've done this before, you don't want to update to the latest version of the operating system only to have your most used piece of software all of a sudden not work. And so, to be honest, I've only run into one actual bug so far, and it has to do with my external monitor. So I'm running the LG 49-inch super ultra wide, and the first time that it rebooted with Catalina and popped up, it was like everything was enormous. Windows were huge. The taskbar at the top was enormous. So do I consider Catalina to be the most boring OS update ever? Because this person does. I don't know if that's just pure hyperbole or they're just like disappointed that maybe there wasn't some other big, huge new feature. I'm actually very excited about Catalina. If all it had was sidecar support, I would be super excited. But the addition of Arcade is really cool to me. The little things like Apple Notes being so much better, like reminders being so much better, Safari being better, there's noticeable stuff. And it's not groundbreaking, mostly not huge groundbreaking new features that you're gonna drool over, but it's stuff that you're definitely gonna use. And I'm glad that Catalina is here, especially for Sidecar. I love Sidecar. All right, so there's several questions about which Macs are gonna be compatible with Catalina. And luckily for you, I got a list right here of the oldest computers in different sections here. So MacBook Pro, you can go MacBook Pro 13-inch mid-2012. MacBook Air, you're looking at MacBook Air 11-inch from mid-2012. For MacBooks, you're looking at the MacBook from 12-inch from early 2015. iMacs, iMac Pro 2017. iMac regular, non-Pro, is all the way back to the 21.5-inch late 2012. For the Mac Mini, you can go back to the Mac Mini from late 2012. And for the Mac Pro, you can do the Mac Pro from late 2013. Now, Sidecar is a different story. You have to have an iPad. Now, Sidecar is a different story. You need to have an iPad that at least has Apple Pencil support in order to make use of Sidecar. I have no idea why this restriction exists. I assume it's probably for a good reason. Maybe they need something that's a little bit more powerful to handle it smoothly. I don't know. And let me bring up my list here again for the Macs that are gonna work with Sidecar. You're gonna need a 27-inch iMac that's a late 2015 or newer. You're gonna need a MacBook Pro that's a 2016 or newer. So even mine just barely snuck in there. You're gonna need a Mac Mini from 2018 or a Mac Pro from 2019, MacBook Air from 2018 or newer, MacBook early 2016 or newer, or iMac Pro from 2017 or newer. So there you go. Hopefully that helps you understand whether or not you're gonna be able to use Catalina or get the most out of it with Sidecar. All right, somebody says that their Mac got frozen up when they were installing Catalina, and I've heard of that happening to a few people. Mine worked just fine, but upgrades can be weird sometimes. It's annoying when you're like all excited, yeah, it's time to upgrade, and then something goes wrong and you're like, why did I upgrade? But here's one thing that I've heard has been working for people with various issues is just to restart your Mac and then everything seems to go fine. So I'm not recommending this officially, because if it doesn't work, don't come blaming me, because that's my disclaimer. But if you hold down the power button for however many seconds until it shuts off and then boot it back up, I've heard that that's been working pretty well for some people. And the resource I'm going to recommend for you is Lori Gill from iMore, because I saw that she had some issues getting all upgraded, and I think she has a whole article about it. I'll try to link it up if I can find it, but do a search for that if you're running into other issues. She's usually pretty awesome about, she's always awesome about getting you set up with new Mac stuff. Somebody says, is there a way to disable automatically updating your Mac from Mojave or whatever you have to Catalina? And the answer is yeah. Like if you still need 32-bit apps or whatever for school, work, yeah, you go to System Preferences and then check out the update section there, and you can turn off automatic updates. I like to keep it on, but obviously I don't need a specific app that needs to run on older architecture, but it should be an option. So yeah, check out your System Preferences. Last question of the day is somebody says, what games do you play? I assume they're talking about Apple Arcade. You know, a long time ago, before Apple Arcade, I was playing Alien something or other, because it was like the highest quality graphics I could get on a Mac at the time, and it was okay, it's pretty impressive. I couldn't even run it at the full settings on my 2016 maxed out MacBook Pro. But anyways, I'm digressing. With Apple Arcade, the first two things that I downloaded were Stellar Commander and Hot Lava. I haven't tried Stellar Commander yet, but for me, there's something about playing on a laptop where like strategy games are just really good for a laptop, harkening back to like Command and Conquer and Age of Empires and whatever. So I decided to give Stellar Commander a try on the Mac, even though I've seen it on the iPad and other platforms. You know, like some games just seem to fit on a certain device. So strategy stuff seems to really go good on a Mac. So I'm gonna check that out. And Hot Lava, I had tried downloading that on one of my other devices, but I ran out of memory. And so I never got a chance to try it until today, actually. And that was pretty cool. Pretty good graphics and just running around. Like it's like the kids game, trying to stay off the floor because it's lava. And yeah, it looks pretty good so far. So those are the two that I've tried. And honestly, there aren't that many arcade games yet the second day into Catalina. So hopefully they're gonna add some more as we keep going. And if so, then maybe I'll update that list of what I like the best on the Mac in my arcade video. All right, so that's gonna do it for this video. Let me know what other questions you have down in the comments. Maybe I or somebody from the community can get those answered for you. Don't forget, you can check out our podcast. That's linked up down below. And also, at Daily Tech, spelled Daily T-E-K-K on Instagram and Twitter. You should check that out. Give us a follow or subscribe over there, because we post a lot of stuff that's like a heads up for content that's coming out. So if you kind of want a preview or if you just want another place to interact and kind of connect with our community, those are the places to do it. All right, I'll catch you in the next video. Later.